Prerna. I'm a clinical psychologist and an associate professor of psychology. In our previous video, we had an overview of the structure and functions of the nervous system of our body. In today's video, we shall exclusively speak about the central nervous system, which is made up of brain and spinal cord. Let us begin with the spinal cord. Spinal cord is a thick bundle of nerves made up of 31 pairs of nerves which carry the message to and from the brain. In fact, the relationship between the spinal cord and the brain is very similar to the relationship between the head of the state and their secretaries. What would you have to do if you have to meet the head of the state? Wouldn't you first meet the secretary who would seek an appointment and then carry your message to the head? Very similarly, every message from our body will first have to approach the spinal cord, which in turn carries the message to the brain. The opposite is also true. All the instructions which have to travel down from the brain will first reach the spinal cord, and then spinal cord will distribute all those messages to different organs of the brain. As you can see, spinal cord performs very, very crucial function of sending messages up and down. And that's the reason why, if spinal cord is damaged, a patient might suffer from paralysis. Why? Let's take an example. Suppose a nerve from the left leg is damaged, then no message from the left leg would reach the brain, and consequently, no instructions from the brain would reach the left leg. And therefore, now the person would suffer from the paralysis of the left leg, wouldn't he? That is why the spinal cord needs to be very well protected. The spinal cord is very, very well protected by a very thick bony structure called spinal case, the one which you feel when you run your fingers down behind your back. Between the thick bundle of nerves, which is the spinal cord, and this very thick bony cage, which is the spinal case, we also have thick liquid called cerebrospinal fluid. So the spinal case and the thick jelly-like cerebrospinal fluid protect the spinal cord. The spinal cord is also almost entirely responsible for the reflex actions. What are these reflex actions? Reflex actions are involuntary, spontaneous actions which protect our body from any injury or harm. For example, what do we do when we accidentally touch a hot flame? Don't we immediately push our hands behind? What do we do if a mosquito is biting us? Don't we instinctively shoo it off? Don't our eyes start watering when a dust particle enters inside? All these are examples of reflex action. They are all involuntary, they are spontaneous, and they all protect our body from damage. It is the spinal cord which takes charge of these reflex actions, thus protecting us from several damages which is inflicted upon us on our day-to-day basis. This is in brief about the structure and functions of the spinal cord. And now we move on to the brain, one of the most interesting and fascinating regions of our body. Our brain is subdivided into three major areas called forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. The word hind itself comes from the word behind, and that's where our hindbrain is, over here at the back of our brain. And it is the first contact point between the spinal cord and the upper regions of the brain. Therefore, all the messages which come from the spinal cord will first enter the hindbrain, and then hindbrain sends the messages to upper regions of the brain. Hindbrain is made up mainly of organs called pons, medulla, and cerebellum. Collectively, they perform some important task. Namely, the most important task they perform is of the traffic control. So just like a traffic controller would give importance and priority to a vehicle like a fire brigade or an ambulance, similarly, our hindbrain will filter out the messages coming from the spinal cord and give importance to urgent and important message which will be first sent to higher regions of the brain. Besides doing the work of a traffic controller, hindbrain also controls our heartbeats and breathing. Hindbrain also gives us our sense of balance, and it is responsible for smooth muscle coordination. It is because of hindbrain that we do not trip and fall every time we change our position from sitting to standing, standing to sleeping, or while dancing. It is because of our hindbrain that we are able to enjoy a packet of popcorn while walking on a busy street. All these actions are smoothly performed without us falling off and tripping because hindbrain provides us that sense of balance. Moving further, situated just above the hindbrain is a tiny structure called midbrain. Mid because it is in the middle region. Midbrain is almost like the alarm clock of our body. It does the work of waking us up from sleep, and it is responsible for keeping us awake and alert. The outer layer of the midbrain actually has a very beautiful appearance because you have several neurons moving upwards, ascending towards higher regions of the brain, and they all crisscrossing each other, giving us a net-like appearance. And therefore, midbrain is also known as ARAS, that is ascending reticular activating system, and that's what midbrain is. Any damage to midbrain could lead to a person slipping into coma. And now we move on to the most crucial region of our brain, our forebrain. Forebrain is one of the largest areas of our brain, and forebrain is responsible for vegetative functions which keep us alive and is responsible for survival, like hunger, thirst, sleep, reproduction, avoidance of pain. But what makes forebrain very, very interesting in human being is a region called cerebral cortex. The upper region of forebrain, which is made up of deep grooves and curves, is known as cerebral cortex. It is this cerebral cortex which is responsible for advanced cognitive functioning that we humans are blessed with. So it is our cerebral cortex which is responsible for our thinking, for all our other mental activities like problem solving, decision making, remembering, imagination, daydreaming, understanding, planning, etc. And in fact, as you can see, it is our cerebral cortex which differentiates us from other species. Situated deep within the forebrain is a small system called limbic system. Limbic system is largely composed of thalamus, hypothalamus, amygdala, and hippocampus. Thalamus once again performs the function of a traffic controller, and it is responsible for sending the correct message to the correct regions of the brain. Below the thalamus is a peanut-shaped structure called hypothalamus. In fact, hypo meaning below. Hypothalamus once again is a very interesting region of our brain. It is a tiny peanut-shaped structure, and yet it almost entirely controls our hunger. Hypothalamus has two different centers called feeding center and satiety center. What does the feeding center do? It is responsible for giving us the feeling of hunger, and because we feel hungry, we start searching for food. But what happens once we start eating and we have reached our optimum level? Then you have the satiety center in the hypothalamus, which is activated and gives you the sense of fullness or satisfaction and helps you to stop eating. What would happen if either of them is damaged? In laboratory experiments with animals, when feeding center was destroyed, animals absolutely refused to eat till the point where they reached starvation. In animals, when satiety center was destroyed, they refused to stop eating, and in fact, we had animals growing up to 3 times their original body size. So as you can see, the feeding and satiety centers are very, very crucial to our sense of hunger. Hypothalamus also entirely controls our endocrine system, which is actually a system made up of all our glands. We have several glands in our body, each secreting different hormones, which in turn are responsible for a lot of functions, including a lot of our emotions. So in a way, our hypothalamus is also responsible for a lot of feelings, moods and emotions. Isn't it surprising that a tiny peanut-like structure could actually be responsible for so many things? It surely is. Then of course, there is amygdala. Amygdala is almost entirely responsible for our emotion of fear. Why is fear so important? Fear is important because unless and until you're scared of something, you would not be surviving for too long. I do not go and sit on the parapet of the terrace of my building because my amygdala makes me scared. But if amygdala did not give me that fear, I would have taken that risk and probably tripped and fallen and died. I do not hang out of a fast moving train because I have fear, and that fear comes to me from amygdala. If my amygdala was destroyed, I would have taken undue risk. I would go on bungee jumping, paragliding without any safety equipments, which would most definitely result in a serious accident, instantly killing me. So amygdala gives us fear, and that fear keeps us in check, does not allow us to take risk, and therefore protects us from damage and death. In patients where amygdala has been destroyed or damaged, these patients have been found to become completely fearless and therefore constantly at risk also. And finally, our hippocampus. Up till now, little is understood about hippocampus, but research shows that hippocampus plays a very important role in the formation of new memories. Research with patients where hippocampus has been damaged has shown us that previous memories are intact, but they are incapable of forming new memories. This could be pretty destructive, because if you're not able to form new memories, then your life sort of stops before the accident. And then after the accident, every day becomes a new day in your life. That could be pretty painful for the patient and the relatives around them. Today, what we have seen in our video is a small brief overview of our central nervous system. In the following videos, we shall have many such topics to discuss about the biology of our behavior. Please do not forget to subscribe and ring the bell icon. Please do like and share this video. Thank you for watching. Have a happy day.